The David C. Alston Scholarship is now open for all college students and trade school students in the 2024-2025 school year. The scholarship is open to all eligible church members, so apply now. On April 24th, after the 11 o'clock service, we will be holding a new members fellowship. If you've become a new member in the last few years, we want to get a chance to know you. So come on out. Refreshments will be served. The time has come to celebrate Passion Week, and the best place to do it is at Fort Foote Baptist Church. Our celebration starts on Sunday, March 24th for our 7:30 and 11 a.m. Palm Sunday service. We will also be having a day of prayer on Thursday, March 28th from 12 p.m. to 6 p.m. in the sanctuary. Our celebration continues with our Good Friday Seven Last Words on March 29th at 7 p.m. This brings us to Easter morning with our sunrise service on March 31st at 6 a.m. But that's not the end, as we continue with our Easter celebration at our 7:30 and 11 a.m. services. So come out and celebrate our Lord Jesus Christ at Fort Foote Baptist Church. Here are some opportunities to serve at the Fort. Vacation Bible School is looking for volunteers. For more information, there is a sign-up table in the vestibule after both services. Our monthly food distribution will be held on Saturday, March 23rd at 9 a.m. For more information or to volunteer, contact Reverend Joseph Brown. The Missions Ministry is planning a trip to Tobago, and they are asking for donations to help them fund the trip. For more information, contact Reverend Joseph Brown. The David C. Alston Scholarship is now open for all college students and trade school students in the 2024-2025 school year. The scholarship is open to all eligible church members, so apply now. On April 24th, after the 11 o'clock service, we will be holding a new members fellowship. If you've become a new member in the last few years, we want to get a chance to know you. So come on out. Refreshments will be served. The time has come to celebrate Passion Week, and the best place to do it is at Fort Foote Baptist Church. Our celebration starts on Sunday, March 24th for our 7:30 and 11 a.m. Palm Sunday service. We will also be having a day of prayer on Thursday, March 28th from 12 p.m. to 6 p.m. in the sanctuary. Our celebration continues with our Good Friday Seven Last Words on March 29th at 7 p.m. This brings us to Easter morning with our sunrise service on March 31st at 6 a.m. But that's not the end, as we continue with our Easter celebration at our 7:30 and 11 a.m. services. So come out and celebrate our Lord Jesus Christ at Fort Foote Baptist Church. Here are some opportunities to serve at the Fort. Vacation Bible School is looking for volunteers. For more information, there is a sign-up table in the vestibule after both services. Our monthly food distribution will be held on Saturday, March 23rd at 9 a.m. For more information or to volunteer, contact Reverend Joseph Brown. The Missions Ministry is planning a trip to Tobago, and they are asking for donations to help them fund the trip. For more information, contact Reverend Joseph Brown.
and letting God know that we worship him. Stand to your feet. It's still worship time. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give God some glory. Let's magnify his name. Hallelujah. Come on, come on.
We worship you. In the beauty of holiness, we worship you. In the beauty of holiness, come on, sing it with us. You in the beauty of holiness. Come on, let's lift his name. We worship you.
We worship you.
Again, hallelujah. Come on, let's worship him. Come on.
We worship you.
Holy,
yeah.
Oh.
My name is Willie Cooper, and we do come to worship the Almighty God in the beauty of holiness. And as I look around to say congratulations to all the women's today, included the man. I am grateful for this opportunity. Shall we pray? Eternal God, our Heavenly Father, yes, indeed, we came to worship you in the beauty of holiness. Not only to worship you, dear Father, but we came reaching out and reaching high for your love that we might spread it abroad. I'm so grateful, so thankful for this day, a day that we never witnessed before, but a day that we understand that we got a race to run. Let us run it with patience, Almighty God. One thing we do know, that in this race, we look to Jesus. And as we look to Jesus, we can see his handiwork. We can see what he's doing, and we know that one day he will return. And we just want to be ready, dear Heavenly Father. We just want to do the things that's well pleasing to you. We want to be more compassionate. We want to be more loving and kind, because we know one day, Almighty God, that we are going to be in that number. Don't care whether it's in the front or the back, we just want to be there. And as we look and see the cross of Calvary that saved us and gave us salvation through his blood. Oh, hallelujah, we are so thankful, so grateful. And I'm thankful that you woke me up this morning, Lord. I'm thankful, Almighty God, that you let me sleep and rest last night. And I'm so thankful, dear God, that we have loved ones and friends and all of these, Lord, that just asking you to bless them and take care of them. And then, Almighty God, as you come in the midst of this program today, just be with each one of us. Let us, Almighty God, look to you, who is the light, who is the finisher of our salvation. Let us look to you, Almighty God, with eyes wide open, knowing that we can see you in all things, Almighty God. Just have mercy upon us. Asking you, Lord, to bless our pastor, bless his wife. But I ask you also, Lord, to bless his whole congregation, that we might live for thee, because one day we can say we can be satisfied, knowing that you are the true living God. Bless us and keep us this day. In the mighty name of your son, Jesus, I pray and ask it. Amen. 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 Amen.
Ha! God is good. Troubles of life seem to get you down. Well, I got a friend, and I like to recommend. He will stick closer than a brother, and he'll love you like no other, yeah.
Me free.
Yes, I see.
He protected me. I see him working. Good morning, and welcome to Foote Baptist Church. My name is Joy Alston, and it is my sincere honor and indeed a great privilege to extend a special welcome to our guests today and to those who are worshiping with us on live stream. So today is Women's Day at the Foote. Our theme this year is fixing our eyes on Jesus. When life is difficult, frustrating, and discouraging, don't give up. Look up and fix your eyes on Jesus. If you're a visitor, would you please stand? Our ushers would love to give you a welcome card to complete. On the back of the welcome card is a prayer card for you to fill out. Please drop the card in the offering basket or hand it to one of the ushers. You may be seated. Thank you. On behalf of our pastor, Reverend Dr. Joseph W. Lyles, and our First Lady, Sister Sheila Lyles, we thank you for choosing to worship with us today. Not only do we want to welcome our guests, but we want to recognize all women in the church. Will all women in the church please stand? Today we are celebrating you because each of you play a critical role in the church and in society. Congratulations. Congregation, would you please turn around and look at all of the beautiful women, including our choir. All of our beautiful women. You may be seated. Thank you. Not only are we celebrating all of the women of the church, but today we are honoring all widows in the church. So will all widows please stand or raise your hand? Please look at their faces, how they shine with the love of God. We have a small token for each of you. Ushers, would you please pass out the tokens of love at this time? Each of you will receive a blue and gold lighted flower, which also represents the Kingdom Women Ministry colors. We thank our Heavenly Father. We thank our Heavenly Father for allowing us to honor you today at our Women's Day program. In many cases, you are the women whose shoulders we stood on, the Titus II women who taught us by their example and reminded us to stay focused on Christ. In the midst of difficulties, you kept your eyes fixed on Jesus. You did not give up. You looked up. And we thank God for each of you on this day. You may be seated. Thank you. Enjoy the rest of the service. God bless you all. Thank you.
The David C. Alston Scholarship is now open for all college students and trade school students in the 2024-2025 school year. The scholarship is open to all eligible church members, so apply now. On April 24th, after the 11 o'clock service, we'll be holding a new members' fellowship. If you've become a new member in the last few years, we want to get a chance to know you. So come on out. Refreshments will be served. The time has come to celebrate Passion Week, and the best place to do it is at Fort Foote Baptist Church. Our celebration starts on Sunday, March 24th for our 7:30 and 11 a.m. Palm Sunday service. We will also be having a day of prayer on Thursday, March 28th from 12 p.m. to 6 p.m. in the sanctuary. Our celebration continues with our Good Friday Seven Last Words on March 29th at 7 p.m. This brings us to Easter morning with our sunrise service on March 31st at 6 a.m. But that's not the end, as we continue with our Easter celebration at our 7:30 and 11 a.m. services. So come out and celebrate our Lord Jesus Christ at Fort Foote Baptist Church. Here are some opportunities to serve at the Fort. Vacation Bible School is looking for volunteers. For more information, there is a sign-up table in the vestibule after both services. Our monthly food distribution will be held on Saturday, March 23rd at 9 a.m. For more information or to volunteer, contact Reverend Joseph Brown. The Missions Ministry is planning a trip to Tobago, and they are asking for donations to help them fund the trip. For more information, contact Reverend Joseph Brown.
Here to read about the occasion for today, for Women's Day 2024. Again, Kingdom Women, a theme is fixing our eyes on Jesus when life is difficult, frustrating, or discouraging. Don't give up, look up, and fix your eyes on Jesus. Kingdom Women, women of divine power, purpose, and influence. Fixing our eyes on Jesus means to turn our focus away from other things and continuously focusing on Jesus. This implies placing Jesus at the center of our thoughts, actions, and decisions. When life is difficult, frustrating, and discouraging, don't give up, look up, and fix your eyes on Jesus. When we fix our eyes on Jesus, our lives begin to change for the better, and we become more like Him. To keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, we need to stay connected to Him. Regular prayer and Bible study are two key ways to maintain this connection. This allows us to understand His teachings, experience His presence, and seek His guidance. It's like tuning into a radio frequency. The more we tune into God's frequency through prayer and scripture, the clearer His voice becomes to us. Just as Jesus endured the cross, we can learn to view our challenges and trials as opportunities for growth. This doesn't mean we should seek out suffering, but when we encounter difficulties, we can ask, what can I learn from this? How can this situation help me grow in my faith and character? Remember, every challenge is temporary, but the spiritual growth we gain from it can have eternal benefits. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2 reminds us to focus on the eternal joy set before us. This might involve making decisions that don't make sense from a worldly perspective, like sacrificing personal comfort for the sake of serving others, or standing up for Christian values even when they're not popular. But as we make these choices, we're following the footsteps of Jesus, who despised the shame for the joy set before Him. Fix our eyes on Jesus, the perfect example of faith and perseverance. Like the Israelites at the Red Sea, we are called to trust God's deliverance even in the face of overwhelming obstacles. Our joy lies in the promise of salvation and the eternal kingdom of God. Thank you.
Tell him I wanna be where you are.
Wanna be where you are.
it takes just to see you, to behold you as my king. I want to be where you are. Peace is where you are. Joy is where you are. And love is who you are.
This audiobook on Amazon has made me...
I heard this week that, you know, life be lifing, but somebody else said God be God. And does God be God for y'all? Yes, he be God, because she had a allergic reaction yesterday. But we here. You know, devil can't stop you. Amen. The next time you find your head hung low because you've poured out more than what's been poured in, you may feel your head being pulled to look to the heavens. That's God reminding you not to forget him. He wants you to lay it out all on the floor. Here you don't have to hide behind makeup, heels, or the clothes that you wore. He wants your honesty, the ugly truth, even if everything and everyone has told you to mask your feelings. You've been wearing the mask so long that you don't even recognize who you are anymore. Always on the go due to the many hats that you wear and the roles that you fill. Trying to fit into shoes of what society and the generational trauma before you have placed you in. Getting frustrated and discouraged because the measurements aren't tailored to who you are and your purpose. You spend more time questioning than looking for the answers. Praying for God to send you the signs that you still ignore. Because you're afraid of what's in store. The unknown makes you uneasy. But did you forget that you are not in control? Amen. Beautiful sis, I want you to love yourself unconditionally. Start giving yourself the grace that God gives you. Celebrate your wins as mighty as you cry over your losses. Stop living your life in comparison and feeling the weight of failure when you feel like you don't measure up. You are uniquely and majestically made to serve a purpose that is known to you and God. I once read that you must heed the omens. So pay more attention to the signs and the direction in which God is pointing you. The vision may not always align with what other people want for you, but it's the journey that God has prepared for you. But first, I need you to take care of you, okay? I need you to take care of you. How often do you go through the day with your mouth saying yes, but your body and mind saying no? I heard somebody, yeah, you know. You come next on your list of things to do. Stop ignoring the call that screams and sighs and begs you to rest. Rest is not a reward, but a requirement. I'm gonna run it back because y'all seem like y'all felt that. Rest is not a reward, but a requirement. He calls you to rest so that way you can clear your mind and rest your soul. Empty what weighs on your heart so you can get closer to him. I know you want everything at its best, but that's not possible if you don't rest. And honey, you look too good and too fine, and you are too blessed to be that stressed. So release what's holding you. If you gotta scream or shout or take a walk or even dance in the rain, I'm just saying, Proverbs 31:25 says, "For she who is clothed with strength and dignity, she laughs without fear of the future." So stop worrying about what everybody else is gonna say, because who gonna check you, boo? Okay? All you need to worry about is that God sees you. He's waiting on you to let your light shine at his brightest. He's waiting on you to wake up renewed so you can pay attention to every answered prayer that he is setting up for you. You are powerful. You are so powerful that your tears flourish the flowers that make bloom in the ground. You are forever evolving into the women that you dreamed of becoming. You're her story. You are someone's answered prayer, and I want you to never forget how uniquely and wonderfully made you are. And you're here for a purpose. So continue to always heed that sign that tells you to lift your head and look to the heavens. That's God there reminding you to not forget him. Thank you.
Going down. Jesus. How precious is the name of Jesus. If I had on some different shoes, I might want to run around the perimeter, because truly precious is his name. It is so good to be here with you. Praise God. Praise God. Can we praise God together? Now, I will have to make a confession. I usually only talk to Jesus at 7:30 in the morning. But I am glad to be here with you as you are worshiping our Lord and Savior in spirit and in truth. It's such a sweet spirit in this place, and I know it is the spirit of the Lord. It is so great to be with you again and to see all of you. I'm so grateful for this invitation. Reverend Lyles called, and I think it took me a minute to get back to him, and I was nervous because I was traveling and all over the place, and I was like, when Dr. Lyles calls, you must call him back. He is truly a giant in the kingdom, and we ought to celebrate who he is and all that he has brought. It has just been a blessing to watch him and to journey with him, even as he has shepherded this branch of Zion, but also been a witness to so many of us in the DMV and around, I would say around the country, for the ministry that you have here. Do not take it for granted that you have an angel over this house who loves the Lord. Amen, somebody. Amen, somebody. Do not take it for granted. First Lady Lyles, who has just such a sweet spirit. I always just feel like I should take her with me because she just resonates Jesus all just by her presence. And she does such a wonderful job here and is such a blessing to the kingdom. My daughter was going to come with me but wasn't feeling well this morning. She is watching online. She has been texting me throughout the service, and she said, your two young adult children love you very much. And so she's like, I'm praying for you, Mom. My son just turned 24 last week, so he is with his Morehouse brothers, and they are celebrating there. So I'm not sure if he's watching, but I know she's watching. So I'm so excited about this theme and this time of sharing for the women. Truly, this is a time when we should be coming together and knowing and understanding that we have to fix our eyes on Jesus. I was thinking about that Hebrews 12 text, and two things came to mind. One thing dropped in my spirit. One thing was a reminder. I was traveling back home. I think it was from Charlotte. I have been on the road quite a bit, and I'm on a flight, It was morning. I was tired. You know how you get and you're just in your seat. I didn't have anybody next to me. I was like, I can just be quiet and just take a nap, right? Pray that this plane, the door don't fall off or whatever. I didn't know about the doors falling off at the time. But I'm sitting there, and this young lady is behind, a little girl is behind me, and she starts yelling to her mom as the plane lifts off. She starts yelling to her mom, Mom, where is God? I want to see God. Is God in the clouds? I don't see. And she's looking out the window searching for God, because clearly her mom raised her well and is telling her God is in the heavens. And then she sees that we're in the heavens, and she's like, where is God, Mommy? I want to see God. And so I was like, Lord, not yet. I want to see God too, but not today. But that Hebrews text, the great cloud of witnesses, also reminds me that we should be leveling up. Amen. That we have nothing to be afraid of, that we have nothing to fear, that in spite of what we go through and what we're going through, in spite of the obstacles and the suffering and the challenges, we need to level up, because there is a great cloud of witnesses that have gone before us. Amen. Amen. That's a word, not a sermon, but that's a word. So level up, level up. I want to go quickly to my text and just share with you for a few moments. If you will turn with me to Mark, the book of Mark. And this is not the Bible that I normally use, but I brought it and I'm going to give it to you. It is the New Revised Standard Version, updated edition, which the National Council of Churches owns the copyright. So that is hot off the press and new, and I want to gift it to you. And I also, I was sharing that when you are a woman of a certain age, that sometimes reading certain fonts becomes more of a challenge. So I'm going to use my phone. Amen, somebody. Mark chapter 6, verses 6 through 13, I believe. I'm going to stop there. And he was amazed at their unbelief. I believe what you will see is the New King James Version, yes. And he marveled because of their unbelief. Then he went about the villages in a circuit teaching. He called the 12 and began to send them out two by two and gave them authority over unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. He said to them, wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you and they refuse to hear you as you leave, shake the dust off your feet as a testimony against them. Lord, have mercy. So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. I want to preach for the next few moments of our time of sharing using the title, Understanding the Assignment. Understanding the assignment. Let us pray. Gracious and merciful God, we come before you grateful for another day, grateful for this morning, grateful for your presence that is in this place. We pray, God, that you would meet our very need. God, we want to hear from you. We need, oh God, to hear from you. So we ask, God, that you would do what only you can in this moment, that you would change our agenda. Yeah, we just got up. Yeah, we came to worship. But God, we need you to do something in us that you might be able to do something through us. So we bless you now. Let me hide behind your cross. We pray, oh God, that it would be your words in my mouth. It's in the mighty and the matchless name of Jesus we do pray and ask it all. Amen. Amen. Understanding the assignment. Saints, today as we are gathered at a time when the most optimistic among us would have to call perilous times. As we emerge from 3 years of pandemic life, things are just not the same. No matter how much we'd like for them to go back to normal. Amen, somebody. More than 1.1 million people lost their lives to COVID. Numbers of cases and hospitalizations going up and down, back and forth. It is estimated that at least 1 million are living with long COVID. Lord, have mercy on us. We went from mass unemployment to mass inflation to what I want to suggest to you is mass price gouging. Amen. And the pandemic does not even begin to tell the whole story. We've emerged, and yet we see there are wars and rumors of wars in the Middle East, in the Sudan, in the Congo, in Haiti, upheaval. We know, oh God, that there's famine and extreme poverty and climate disasters and political upheaval even in our own country. We're a nation that has been filled with rampant gun violence and a resurgence of racial vitriol, rising suicide rates, a far-reaching mental health crisis, white supremacists and misogynistic wolves dressed up in pro-life sheep's clothing, voter suppression, and a democracy at risk and in peril. Fear is not only a factor, but it has been weaponized to manipulate and con us into acting and voting against our own interests. A nation where our efforts to tell the truth about our history, the truth that sets us free, is being apprehended by toxic polarization and political meandering, Christian nationalism and white supremacist ideology. A nation, I would suggest to you, that is mad about wokeness, but not about mass shootings, where books will be banned, but not military-grade assault weapons, which puts each and every one of us in harm's way as we go about our daily routines. Lord, have mercy on us. Not only that, consider the state of the church, Big C. A church faced with declining numbers and resources. A church that seems to be fighting against itself, with people literally bowing down to images of former presidents and considering them to be like Jesus. While others are marching and shouting Black Lives Matter or providing help to those at the border who are in need. I was teaching in New York yesterday and I was sharing, I have been to the border a couple of times as a part of delegations just to minister to people and to bear witness to what's going on there. And I just said to the, at this summit, and I want to just share this, nobody's coming across the border. Like, they walk through the desert. It takes 3 months to walk through the desert. They're not coming because they feel like they have options. And we need to be praying that we can find solutions that will help the people who are most in need and help those of us to receive them. Because my Bible says, welcome the strangers. I'm not sure about yours, but it's Old Testament and New Testament. We're a church where some say women have no place leading, but others of us know better. Amen. Amen. A church where some are trying to legislate and force their beliefs on others, while others are trying to take seriously what it means to be a disciple, what it means to be a witness, what it means to hold up the banner. Jesus said, if I am lifted up, I'll draw all people unto me. You don't have to legislate. You don't have to make it. Lift up Jesus. Be a disciple, and all people will be drawn to him. A church where building a vibrant ministry that truly makes disciples in the midst of distractions and social media and short attention spans is no small feat. The most optimistic of us, I would suggest to you, would say we are living in perilous times. Amen, somebody. Indeed, the context for ministry within and outside the church walls will make us scratch our heads and drop to our knees. That is why it is important, it is crucial, it is significant for us to understand the assignment. Now, according to the Urban Dictionary, understanding the assignment means to go above and beyond, to exceed expectations. It was popularized by the rapper Tay Money in her song, The Assignment, with lyrics that cannot be repeated in church. Suffice it to say, it means you did the thing, you killed it, you slayed, you did the doggone thing. And we know people who we can say without equivocation have understood the assignment. Can I call the roll? Harriet Tubman freed hundreds of slaves, but said she would have freed more if they only knew they were slaves. She understood the assignment. Frederick Douglass was a great orator and abolitionist, calling slaveholders into accountability. He understood the assignment. Shirley Chisholm was unbought and unbossed. She understood the assignment. MLK and John Lewis, they understood the assignment. Venus and Serena Williams have inspired and multiplied a generation of tennis players. It was just the two of them. Now it's like 5 or 10 black women tennis players on the court. They understood the assignment. Sha'Carri Richardson, after being humiliated and removed from competition in 2021 for testing positive for marijuana use after the unexpected death of her biological mother, she embraced the comeback and became the fastest woman alive, winning the 100-meter race in record time. Now, don't hate me on this, but LeBron James... not just because he is arguably the best basketball player in the league and has dominated the game for decades, but also because he built a school in Ohio that gives children a chance to achieve and their parents to get GEDs. And he has poured into his family. He understood the assignment. Gardner Taylor, Prathia Hall, Joseph Lyles, and the list goes on and on and on. They understood the assignment. David McElveen, who I always think about when I come here, he understood the assignment. Now, success in God's eyes is not the same as success in the world. In fact, in ministry, it's not about success. It's about faithfulness. It's not about numbers, it's about obedience. It's not about who joins, it's about the seeds that are planted and those that are watered as God gives the increase. I want to suggest to you today that this is a moment at pause and for us to pause and consider what it means, what it will mean for us to do God's assignment with excellence, to go above and beyond. As we look to Jesus, we know that God will fix it, that Jesus will fix it. What does it mean, though, for us to do what God has called and purposed for us to do? What will it look like for Fort Foote in this increasingly hostile environment to operate with courage and conviction, with character and authenticity, with fortitude and resilience and determination? How will you operate out of excellence and exceed your own expectations, knowing that God's got you and is with you every step along the way? There are a few things I want to suggest to you today as we can take from this text, and then I will go to my seat and we can go to brunch. Amen. Or whatever version of brunch you will do today. In our text today, we find Jesus giving the disciples instructions to go out and minister to the people in the region around Nazareth, his hometown where he is rejected. In Mark's action-packed gospel account, this assignment comes at a very interesting moment for the disciples. It is after Jesus delivers Legion from thousands of demons. It is after he raises Jairus, his daughter, from the dead, and after he is rejected by his own, who wondered out loud, "Where did this man get all of this? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? What is this wisdom that has been given to him?" They were questioning his power and his authority. They were questioning his lineage and taking offense at him. It is after, though, after all of that, that Jesus calls the 12 and tells them to go out two by two and to do what he had been doing. I can imagine that they were thinking, he wants us to do what? Seriously, Jesus? Not only is this is the assignment a huge undertaking, but Jesus seems to strip them of some of the tools that they would need to be able to complete the assignment he has given them. Jesus ordered them to take nothing for their journey but a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belt. In other words, he is sending them out two by two, having to rely on God and one another. It is God who will make provision for them. It is God who will make a way out of no way. It is God who will open the doors and the windows on their behalf. It will not be because of what they have. It will be because God has made a way for them. Amen. Amen. I recently, at my job, we embarked on this, what we call the Pilgrimage for Peace, on Ash Wednesday. We started in Philadelphia and walked from Philadelphia to Washington, D.C. I was on this pilgrimage. We were walking and praying for peace in Gaza. We were praying for a ceasefire. We were praying that all the hostages would be freed. And we were praying that humanitarian aid would flow freely. This was an interfaith group. We had rabbis, we had Buddhists, we had Christians, we had Muslims, and we all were walking literally along the highway. And sometimes, even with our best efforts to plan the day ahead, there were so many different factors that we couldn't always plan for what was going to happen that day. And we ended up at one point at a church, and we had tried to call the church, but nobody answers the phone at the church anymore. I don't know. So we couldn't get in touch with them, and we were trying to just have a place to have lunch. And we were in an area, we weren't sure. We had a couple ideas where we could buy the lunch, but you know, we weren't really sure. We wanted a recommendation. We go, we end up, we pray. Me and one of my colleagues are in my car. I'm like, okay, let's try to find that church that we left them a message. And I said, we just need to pray. So we start praying. We get off the highway, and the church is to the right of us. Not even kidding. So I'm like, okay, let's go in. Let's see. No cars in the parking lot. We go around to the back of the church. So I say to her, my colleague, I say, okay, let's go in. Let's knock on the door. But let's pray that we won't be offended if they don't give us any assistance, right? Let's pray that we won't be in our feelings, because, you know, seriously, we could have been like, you're not going to help, but you know. So I said, let's just pray that God will go before us, that we will not be in our feelings. We knock on the door, the church secretary answers, administrator answers, and we tell her what's going on. She says, we would love to welcome you. We gave us water, set up their fellowship hall for us, called people to help us. I mean, it was a great outpouring, and it helped me to understand why hospitality is so important, why radical Christian hospitality is so important. When you are walking along a highway and you're not sure exactly what's going to happen and you have about 40 people walking with you, you need God to go with you every step along the way, to go before you and to make a way for you. I promise you, it was one of the experiences that I've learned maybe more than some others, that we can believe in God, but we gotta trust God. That trusting and believing are not the same thing. And that while we believe, God is trying to inch us toward trusting him in everything, in the small things, in the big things, in the things that keep us up at night, and the things that help us to have peace. God is asking us to trust them. Take nothing for your journey. Jesus then tells them to take off, to remove their privilege. Amen, somebody. You see, to wear sandals and only one tunic instead of two would signal to those who encountered them that they were of little means. It was peasants who only had one tunic to wear. So it's as if Jesus was telling them to take off their privilege as they go to minister to the people. He then tells them, if you are welcome as you are, make yourself at home and stay in that one place. But if you are not welcome, and we all remember this because we all had a moment in our lives where we wanted to shake the dust off our feet in somebody because of somebody not welcoming us or how we were treated. But Jesus says, shake the dust off off your feet if they don't welcome you. And guess what? Keep it moving. Don't plot and plan for revenge. Don't think about how you're going to get them back. Don't think about how, ooh, if they ever call me, I'm not going to ever. No, keep it moving is what Jesus says. Knowing the assignment means knowing that everyone will not welcome you. Everyone will not embrace your gifts. It's hard to imagine, but everyone will not care that you are from Fort Foote Baptist Church. But your job will not be to impress them. Your job will not be to convince them that you are worthy or gifted or even called. Your assignment is to take the authority that has been given to you over unclean spirits and do the work anyhow. Now, I recognize as a Black woman that there are many spaces where I don't have privilege. I also know that I do have some. Stay with me here. I have 4 degrees and received an honorary doctorate from Ursinus College last year. I work for the National Council of the Churches of Christ in the USA, and often I'm in spaces and places with people of high regard and prestige that quite frankly blow my mind. Although I grew up on the wrong side of the tracks and money earning Mount Vernon, I now live in Montgomery County, one of the richest in the country. My bank account, amen, nor my assets look like many of my neighbors, but I recognize that I have privilege. Privilege that I've earned and worked hard to get. Privilege that my grandparents and my parents sacrificed so that I would have. But here it is, as if Jesus is saying, don't tell them about your degrees. Don't tell them what kind of car you drive or where you live or what kind of clothes you wear or how many clothes and shoes are lined up in your closet. Don't tell them about your iPhone or your watch or your iPad or the Tesla you drive and the material things you have. Don't tell them that you eat with presidents and CEOs and people who have power on earth. No, those things are not relevant for the assignment. You won't be able to slay any unclean demons and spirits with material things. Amen. You won't be able to cast out these demons because you know people. You need to do a different kind of slaying for this assignment. You need a different kind of bank account for this assignment. The kind where you deposit goodness and mercy and patience and long suffering and gentleness and self-control. Love for God's people and for justice. This bank account gets full from doing justice and loving mercy and walking humbly with our God. This bank account increases on your knees with prayer and fasting and going before God to fill you up so that you can fill other people up. Remove your privilege. Take off your privilege so that they won't be so distracted by you that they will miss God. Rely on God, saints. Remove your privilege. And finally, repent. The disciples went forth and proclaimed that all should repent. They called the people to be in right relationship with God, not the religious institutions of the day, not the pastor or the trustees or the deacons, not the community leaders or the politicians, not even their family members or loved ones. The disciples went out and proclaimed that all should repent and be in right relationship with God. Now, we hope that once people are in right relationship with God, they will be transformed. Amen. And consequently, everyone and everything around them will change because they're transformed, because we're transformed. We pray that our families will change, our church will change, our communities will change, Bebe and them will change. The first step is to repent. The first step is to acknowledge that we have fallen short, that we haven't gotten it right, that we need a God to rescue us from our sin and from ourselves. That if we confess with our mouth, says the word, and believe in our hearts, God calls us to repent. And guess what happened in this text? Jesus gave them authority over unclean spirits and tells them to go into the unknown, equipped with what they have seen him do and not much else. And the gospel records that they, in fact, understood the assignment. The word says they cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. The record shows that they understood the assignment because they didn't just go to one stop and turn back because they were scared, but they kept going and kept going and kept going and kept going. And people were healed and delivered and set free, and Jesus was lifted up. The disciples who were once scared and unsure of themselves and what it meant to walk with Jesus were able to do the assignment well because Jesus gave them the authority and they used it. Amen. Jesus gave them the authority and they used the authority that was given to them. Seems to me that what we need to do in this season is use the authority that has been given to us. Demons don't always show up like legion. Amen. Demons don't always show up obvious, but there are some demons that need to be cast out. My God, even as we were sitting in worship, I got an alert on my phone that 7 people were shot, 2 didn't make it right in D.C. Demons show up in different kinds of ways, and we need to use the authority that has been given to us by Jesus. Understand the assignment. It is not to rack up earthly treasures. It is not to fatten your bank account or to live a high life apart from God's people in a glass house. It is to do the work that has been entrusted to us, to love on God's people, to take off our privilege to meet people where they are, to not build up a fiefdom for ourselves, amen, but to rely on God, to honor God, to trust God, and with excellence, with courage and determination, be faithful and do the assignment so that when our labor is over and there is a great gathering in the heavenly realm, we will hear those words that we all strive to hear. Well done, thy good and faithful servant. You understood the assignment. Well done, thy good and faithful servant. You have understood the assignment. God is calling us in this moment to be more than we've ever been before, to trust God more than we ever have before, to rely on God more than we ever have before, because we have to. Because there are lives that are hanging in the balance. There are people who need a word of encouragement. There are people who need to hear from the church, from believers, those who love God, those who have seen signs and wonders and miracles. They were not for ourselves, but that we would go out and we would tell the world, that we tell our neighbors, that we would tell our families about this God that we serve, who has not left us alone, but who has kept us, who has used us, who has moved in and through us, who died for us, who sacrificed it all for us. And we can say for sure that Jesus truly understood the assignment. When he went up on Calvary's hill, he could have come down. He could have called on legions of angels to come and to sweep him off the cross, but he understood the assignment, that it wasn't about him, that even though the cup didn't pass, it wasn't too much for him to bear, that he was fulfilling the plan that God had, not just for himself, but for you and for me. He died on a cross on Friday, didn't he die? But he didn't stay dead. He got up early on Sunday morning. It was quiet on Saturday, but on early Sunday morning, some women went to the tomb to prepare his body. The women were the ones who met Jesus on the road. The women were the ones who were able to spread the good news that he is not dead, but he is risen just like he said. Won't he do it? Won't he do it? Did he understand the assignment? He understood the assignment, not just for himself and not just for us, but for all of those. He said, go out, not just to Jerusalem, but to the ends of the age, that others might know that he understood the assignment. God bless you, and amen.
All of us have been given an assignment. Go ye therefore and teach all nations. In Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the world. It's going to take all of us to reach the lost in this time in which we live. God wants to use everybody. Every one of us are essential personnel. Not just the ministers, deacons, trustees, or chairperson, deaconess, but every born-again child of God needs to share the good news of Jesus. Mark 16:15 says, go into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature. Do not let the enemy minimize your assignment. God has assigned someone to you to minister to them in a time of need. If you're here today and don't know Jesus, the first assignment is to accept him. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us and will cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Would there be one this morning? What a blessing. What a privilege. If God is speaking to your heart, please obey. Obedience leads to blessings. There'll be blessings pressed down, shaken together, and even running over. Aren't you glad that God included you and me in this great commission? We all have an assignment. Let the world know that Jesus is alive, able to supply all of our needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Let them know that he loves them with an everlasting love. He's so loved. His love is agape. It's immeasurable. Would you accept this precious gift of love this morning? We stand amazed that God will use us imperfect people to lead some to a perfect Savior. Commended his love toward us that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. What amazing agape, everlasting love. Tell the world that no matter what the crisis, no matter how terrible, how taxing, or how traumatic, Jesus is able to save them, for he saved from the guttermost to the uttermost. If you worship this morning with us through live stream, the number on the screen is there for you. Our anointed counselors await to receive your call. They will share with you the love of Jesus Christ. Maybe you're here today and you already know this wonderful Savior. You feel led now to become a part of our loving, caring, Great Commission Church. We invite you to come at this time. We'll welcome you to your new family. We'll share your valors as well as your victories. We will share with you the love of Jesus in this house of prayer. If that is your status and desire this morning, we love and invite you to come at this time. I believe we all have an assignment for this week. let's tell at least one person, at least one this week, of the love of Jesus Christ. They may be at a point of desperation, at a point of despair, have lost hope, are in crisis. Just tell them and show them the love of Jesus. Maybe seated for a moment, please. Think about it, just for you, just for me. How great is our God? We thank God for this Anointed Kingdom Women's Day celebration. What a joy, what a blessing, what a privilege. Well, that's that Kingdom Women chairs will come at this time. This energetic, rousing, exciting, anointed Murphy.
Thank you. Thank you.
Bless the Lord.
Oh, Reverend Hoping. Thank you, Pastor. I tell you right now, I'm just fired up and ready to go. I've been fired up all the time because I've got so many people to look up to keep me fired up. But I'm telling you, as we fix our eyes on Jesus, we're going to keep on doing that. But Reverend Copeland told us also we got to understand our assignment. And I hope you understand that, everybody. We do have an assignment. We need to get involved in our church and our ministries. There's so many things and so much to be done. So I just pray after this day that we will get our assignments right and we will step it up. We'll move beyond and just do great things here. I just want to thank all the women that are here today, my choir, even though I didn't get a solo part, but the women's choir, all the women out here, just everybody. I'm just so thankful. I really am. I want to thank our church administrators, the ushers that helped us out today, our media ministry, security. If I miss somebody, I'm going to say this one word. I want to thank everybody. And so, just in case I miss someone. So I appreciate everybody. I really do. Thank you so very much for coming. And we have something special for you after the service, ladies. So please make sure you go in the hall. We have something special for you. Come and celebrate with us today. Reverend Copeland, can you come down here just 1 minute? I just want, please. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. I just have a little something for you. I'm not supposed to turn my back to the camera, but they don't let me get on off the, thank you, Kathy. This is just a little small token, just to thank you so much for being here with us. And we have something else for you also, but just wanted you to have those white posies with a little orange ribbon around. Thanking you so much for thank you for supporting us today. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. And then I have one more, two more things. Just y'all bear with me. I'm going to let y'all, like she said, we have to go to brunch. I'd like our leads. Kathy, where are you? Come on over. I don't want you to bring anything. You just come over. And where is Sister Deborah Gould? I'm just twirling around on the floor. Where is she? Come. Now, let me tell you about these two ladies. This right here, these two ladies here, they are the chairs for our Women's Day 2024.
Amen, amen.
Yes. Deaconess Debbie Gore and Deaconess Kathy Levitt. They have done a fabulous job. I'm just telling you, they've been over the top. They have just done everything that they were supposed to do to make this day a special day for us. And I hope you won't hold it against me for some of the things that I did, but it was all in love. But they kept it together, and I'm just so grateful, and I thank them for everything. So please just give them another round of applause. They've been working hard.
Amen, amen.
And then, last but not least, I'm going to call you back. I'm trying to do the women's chairperson, but it's not me. I'm behind the scenes, but it's another person that really keeps us going. And she's kind of behind the scenes with me, but she keeps us going and just helping me out, and that's our First Lady. So please. See, standing here, all of our women here in the church and every place, ladies, I just want to thank you and this supporting the First Lady and supporting our church. And this is all from us, Sister Sheila. We love you and thank you so much.
Amen. Praise the Lord. So this is a surprise for Roz, because she didn't know we were planning to give her something as well. So Roz, we love
Amen.
You.
Amen.
And we wanted to give you a small token of love and appreciation for all that you did.
Our God is an awesome God. Book of Proverbs said, many daughters have done virtuously, but the kingdom women of Foote, you excel at them all. We thank God for you.
Well, good morning, good morning. God has truly blessed us today. Can we just for a moment just stand up on our feet and give God the glory? Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Father God. Day. I just want to thank God, first of all, for our pastor, for his love and support with this women's ministry. We have given him a run for his money. Trust me. It has really been an honor to have a pastor who really loved his church and his congregation and support us in a mighty way. And so we thank you, Pastor, so much. And to Reverend Copeland, my dear sister, I am so happy that she's with us today, and thank you for that powerful word. And yes, we all do have an assignment. We want to hear from God. We want to keep our eyes focused on God so we can hear the assignment and then go out and do the things that God has called us to do in a powerful, mighty way. And she said something, she said many things, but one particular thing that really touched my heart, and that is we have authority. God has given us authority, and we need to operate within that authority and stand firm on the word of God and do everything that he has called us to do, but to trust him and to honor him in what we do every day. So again, thank you so much for all that God has done to you, for us, and through you. Amen. And two, one more thing, Pastor, if you don't mind. I want to thank this wonderful team here. I thank God I didn't have to do anything this year but just pray and sit back and watch God move through these beautiful ladies that God has called. And not just them alone. Amen. But there's many who are working behind the scene that we do not see. There are those who are in the kitchen right now getting ready to feed those who are in the choir. For those women who are coming out for a rehearsal, we thank you so much. And real quick, for our sister here who did the word, Sister Hurd, thank you so much. For our dancers, the little girls, how they praise team, the dancers, we thank you so much for bringing them out. Mothers, fathers, thank you for bringing your little ones out so to fellowship with us today as well. And there's someone else that I just want to quickly say. I was told this morning that we have a young adult among us who travels all the way from Baltimore to worship with us, but to teach, to help the women to learn songs, praise and worship. And could Sister Nani please come forward? Is she here or did she step out? She stepped out. We just want to take some time and recognize our young people, our young adults who are working hard with us. And so she comes all the way from Baltimore. I didn't know that. You know, to lead and to teach music. So to God be the glory. Amen.
Amen. Can we thank God one last time for Reverend Dr. Leslie Copeland for that word this morning? You might want to go back and listen again. She was covering many critical, important issues of our time that would minister to our hearts. And we pray that God will continue to use her on a local and a national scale. And she's around the world carrying out her assignment. Thank God she's coming and inspired us to carry out our assignment. Everybody has to be working for the glory of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Thank God again for this anointed Women's Day choir and our gifted musicians. We thank God for all the King and women of Foote, because of you, you make Foote for the strong body of the living Christ.
Pastor,
have a great day. Pastor, celebrate.
Pastor, tell them to go out and go to the... Oh, the women, to get their gift. Yes, thank you.
Right. Somebody said, Reverend, you know, really, truth be told, every day is Women's Day.
Yes, it is.
I don't know, but I was told. God bless you.
It's just been such a blessing to be here and to be in your midst. I do feel like I want to pray for you and the church. That's how I feel led, so I'm going to put this down. So this is not really, are you going to do the benediction or you want me to? Okay, so I'm going to pray and then I'll benedict us. All right, gracious God, we come before you. God, we're thankful for this body of Christ, this branch of Zion called Fort Foote Baptist Church. We're thankful, oh God, for the leader, for the angel of this house, Reverend Dr. Joseph Lyles, who put his hand to the plow and has not looked back. God, we ask that you would move in this place in a special way, that you would do for them exceedingly and abundantly above all they can even think or ask for you to do. God, we know that even though they have done great works, that there is still more, yet more for them to do. So I pray, God, that even as they venture out to do the assignment that you have entrusted to them, that you would pour into them peace and love and joy, that you would pour into them mercy and healing and wholeness, that you would pour into them every single thing that they stand in need of, so that not that they will be lifted up, but that you will be lifted up, oh God, that people will see you through them. We, God, we know that there are many obstacles, but the word said there's an effective door and there are many adversaries. But God, we know that you have lifted up a standard for us, and that standard is Christ, that we have authority. And so I pray, oh God, that even leaving from this place, that we will use the authority you have given us, that we will embrace all of who you are and all of who you have called us to be, that we might be able to do the work that you have called us to do. God, we bless you and we thank you and we lift you up on high, knowing, oh God, that you are the author and the finisher of our faith. The perfecter, oh God, that we are standing with the crowd of witnesses even right now, knowing that the work that you have performed in us, you shall bring it to completion. And now unto him who is able to keep us from falling, the most wise God with majesty, dominion, and power, both for now and forevermore. Amen, amen, and amen.